Hey everybody, welcome to Groundswell Online. So great to have you joining us here today in this way. Hey, if it is one of your first times joining us here at Groundswell, we want to say an extra special welcome to you. Thanks for checking us out. Thanks for joining us for this time together. If you'd like to get more connected with us at Groundswell, find some of the links in the video description below. Find especially the links to connect with us on social media, on Facebook, and on Instagram to stay in the loop on all the things that are going on at Groundswell in the days, the weeks ahead. As well, if you would like to get on our email list, you should check out the connection card. That's just a quick form that's going to allow us to follow up with you and to keep you in the loop on everything that's happening at Groundswell. We are also gathering back in person now, and so if you live in the Truro area and you would be able to come and join us in person, we would love to see you. We'd love to put a face to a name if you're comfortable returning to in-person gatherings. We're gathering every Sunday at 9:15 and 11 a.m. at our Truro location at 759 Prince Street. And today, if you happen to be watching this on Sunday, October the 17th, we're celebrating the grand opening of our building. And so we have gatherings 9:15 and 11 a.m. if you're watching in the morning on October the 17th. Tonight at 6 p.m., we are also gathering for a special time of worship, as today we celebrate all that God has done, is doing, and is going to continue to do through this space in Truro as we seek to create spaces where people from all faith backgrounds can come and journey and join in on a journey of faith, growing to know Jesus more. And so we have a quick video that I'm going to transition to now that shows a little bit more of the space and the before and the after, and just a glimpse into all that God is already doing here at our new location in Truro.
past few months, I have had many opportunities to take people through this new-to-us facility. Now, some were team members, others were friends. Sometimes it actually was just people who came in off the street because the doors were open and they were curious and kind of wondering what was going on inside. And almost every time as I led people through the building, typically the first reaction I would get was, "This place is huge," or, "I can't believe how much space there is. This place goes on forever," which was typically followed by, "There is so much potential." Now, I always assumed that they were actually being serious and not offering the potential encouragement that you give someone when, you know, kind of the what's ahead of them looks like a daunting task that it could be impossible. Or when your child is actually really terrible at a sport, but the coach tells you that they have potential. But rather when they looked around, that they could see something with the capacity to become or develop into something actually really incredible. You know what I mean, right? Like those HGTV shows where someone converts a beautiful farmhouse, beautiful old farmhouse into like some sort of fantastic modern home, or a young child who can sing in tune at the age of two and everyone knows that they're definitely going to be a musician someday. Potential. And I would imagine that is exactly what a small group of people from Onslow Baptist Church thought about 160 years ago, as they saw the community of Truro beginning to establish itself in the heart of Nova Scotia. They saw an opportunity to be a light, to establish a congregation, a church plant of sorts in the middle of a community that showed so much promise for growth. And because they saw potential, in January of 1858, 40 people left Onslow Baptist to start what became known as First Baptist Church. They were sent out. It started out a bit like a portable church. They were meeting at a location called the chapel where traveling preachers and missionaries would often stop and speak, where prayer meetings were happening regularly. But in 1868, their numbers had grown to about 120 people, and the poorly located old chapel wasn't getting any younger and was desperately in need of repair. So the leadership, well, they began to dream about their own building. They took their challenge and they turned it into an opportunity and they moved fast. So in 1868, this growing congregation with faith and vision, they purchased the land at 759 Prince Street, where we meet today, approved the plans for the building, and on the last Sunday of May in 1870, 151 years ago, the building opened. Now, that's not the building that we actually meet in today, because First Baptist continued to grow. And by the early 1950s, the congregation had grown to over 500 members. And once again, their building situation, well, it wasn't working out for them. It had become too small. I mean, it was a pretty great problem to have, but it was still a problem because they still really wanted to reach more people. They wanted to reach out into their community. So yet again, their leadership saw an opportunity and they made an extraordinary decision to demolish their current sanctuary that they had met in for almost 90 years. A building full of memories and firsts where people had come to know and follow Jesus, where young couples had pledged their love to each other in front of their family and friends, where family members had said their final goodbyes to their loved ones, where a congregation sang songs of worship and caught new inspiration for life's trials, where there's lots of Christmas Eve services and all kinds of amazing things. But they made a courageous decision to demolish that building and build a bigger one believing in the potential of what God could do there. Can you imagine what the community's reaction to that must have been? Tearing down a church in the middle of town to build a bigger one? I imagine they either thought they were crazy or inspiring. As we begin this new chapter of Groundswell's story, today as we have this grand opening of our location on Prince Street, I think it's important for us to understand the history that brought us here. And not just the history of First Baptist or of Groundswell, but the history of the church. There is a story that God is telling through his church. And we are just a small piece of that. In fact, we're a small piece of the story of the church in Truro or Nova Scotia. The church of Jesus is way beyond one congregation or denomination. And the message of Jesus has found its way into cultures all around the world, all throughout history. When I think about the 151 years of First Baptist Church, I can't help but wonder if Groundswell will exist 151 years from now. Honestly, I'm doubtful that it will. And I'm actually really okay with that, because building Groundswell is not our goal. Helping people find and follow Jesus is. Now, you would not have to look very far to find statistics or articles written today that would claim that the church in Canada is dying. I mean, really, you just need to take a drive around our province and you'll find numerous church buildings that are run down or have turned into family homes or were sold to someone who now uses it as an Airbnb, that these churches in their heyday were filled with people on a Sunday morning. Or dwindling congregations who are struggling to keep their doors open. But at one time, the church was the heart of the community, and Christianity had a significant impact on our culture. That's not the case today. We live in a very different time, and it can certainly feel like the church is, in fact, dying. Will Groundswell be here 151 years from now? I have no idea. But here is what I know for certain and for sure. The church has not only survived, but thrived for centuries. Imagine the early church, the very first followers of Jesus, a few uneducated disciples who found themselves not just barely making it, but thriving and growing exponentially under the oppression of the Roman government. The government is trying to hunt them down and kill them, and yet the church survived. Around the world, for century after century, the church has faced persecution but continues to grow. We have weathered massive intellectual shifts that have significantly impacted and shaped our world. Philosophers like Voltaire during the Enlightenment of the 18th century predicted that in 100 years, there would be no more Christianity, no more Bibles. And yet the church around the world is still thriving. In 151 years, with or without Groundswell, I am confident that the church in our community will be just fine. Because the church isn't a building or an organization, but a people called by God. And I am certain beyond a shadow of a doubt that in 151 years from now, followers of Jesus will still gather to worship. They'll still be teaching and following God's word. They will still be praying for the sick and standing with the oppressed. They will bring light to the darkness and care for the brokenhearted. They will be a beacon of hope in their communities and a place where outsiders are welcomed in. They will still be marrying people. They will still be burying people. They will still be helping widows and orphans, Followers of Jesus will still be introducing people to the love of Jesus, showing people how to follow him and impact the world around them. The church in 151 years will be just fine. So how am I so confident? Why do I believe that the church will be able to thrive and grow even in the face of opposition? I believe it because I'm not building the church, and neither are you. We may like to think that we are, but that's actually when the church starts to fall apart, when we forget who is building it and what it's for. When we start imposing our preferences or grasping for control, and we forget that we actually are not the builder at all. In the book of Matthew, now the book of Matthew is in the New Testament, the smaller section towards the end. It's the very first section of the New Testament. In chapter 16, we find Jesus talking to his disciples, those people in his inner circle who traveled with him and learned from him, watching him perform miracles, and they were trying to follow in his ways. And in their conversation, Jesus makes them a promise. He makes a promise. Now, sometimes people make promises they can't keep. Like, when I promise myself I won't eat any more chips before I go to bed. Generally a promise I can't keep. But when Jesus makes a promise, you can be certain he is going to follow through. And in verse 18, Jesus says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Jesus is building his church, not us. We have the opportunity to join him, but he is always the builder, past, present, and future. And our responsibility is to join him where he is already working, becoming part of the redemptive story that he is writing through his church. Now, maybe you are here today and the last thing you want is to be associated with the church. I mean, let's be honest, the church doesn't always have the best reputation. I get it. I feel that way too sometimes. But I'd like to suggest to you today that sometimes the church forgets who she is, or more importantly, who God intended her to be. The Greek word being used here for church is ekklesia. And in the Greco-Roman world, ekklesia wasn't actually a religious term at all. It was used to describe a group of citizens called out to conduct civic business. So people who came together to do the work of the city for the sake of the city. And Jesus uses this term as a picture for his church, his people, his followers, his kingdom citizens, living with kingdom values, bringing more of his kingdom to the communities that they live in. I think Christians often mistakenly think that the goal of the Christian life is to get to heaven, but the actual goal is to bring more of heaven to earth. Heaven is a place of peace, forgiveness, grace, healing, inclusion, justice. And Jesus wants his church to participate in bringing more of heaven to earth. That's the work of the church. What do you imagine Jesus was thinking as he delivered this promise to his messed up, flawed group of disciples? Men with tempers and pride, with questionable pasts and flawed judgment, who questioned and struggled to follow him and his ways. Some who, when things got tough, they would actually deny ever knowing him. What did he see when he looked at them? His very first ecclesia, the people who would become his church. I think he saw potential. There's a beautiful scene in the final episode of season 2 of The Chosen. Now, if you haven't heard me talk about The Chosen before, it is a series on the life of Jesus and his disciples, and I think everybody should watch it. It's amazing. And Jesus, in this scene, is preparing a message that is going to be delivered to a large crowd that the disciples are gathering. It's known to us as the Sermon on the Mount. Now, in this scene, Jesus, he's working with Matthew. Matthew is kind of like his scribe, and he's working with Matthew to record the words. And as he recites the opening lines that he has prepared for this message, one by one, the faces of the disciples appear on the screen. See, he didn't see their flaws or their failings, the mistakes that they had made or that they would make. He saw their potential to be his church. He said this, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." See, I believe that when God looks at you and he looks at me, he sees potential. He sees the potential, that the unique potential that he has placed in you. He sees the strength that has come from your suffering, the empathy that has developed because of your trauma, your longing for freedom for the oppressed, your brokenness for the suffering, your heart for the down and out. He sees the beauty that can come out of the ashes of your life. And he says, come, come to me. Be my church. Be part of what I am building. Bring more peace, more forgiveness and grace. Bring more inclusion and justice to this community that I have placed you in. You don't have to build it. It will be here long after us. But I have placed something special and unique in you that can make a difference in the lives of the people around you. Come be my church. On May 5th, 1957, the last worship service in the original First Baptist Church building was held, and Reverend George Allen delivered a pretty powerful message to the congregation as they prepared to step out in faith. And I have the opportunity to read some of that in a little historical book on First Baptist Church. And in it, he said this, "What we are doing is in line with our historical precedent. We are doing what the fathers of this church did. We are illustrating their spirit. We are doing what they would do if they were in our place today. We are following their example, and their mantle has fallen upon us. 88 years ago, this with sanctified common sense," that's a great line, "they seized the wider opportunities which God gave them here. Today, we seize the wider opportunities, the potential which God gives us. Did we not do this, we should be unworthy descendants of our noble forebears. May God grant that our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren be governed by an equally wise and sanctified ambition." Now, what some of you may not know is there were two other churches that were birthed out of First Baptist Church in Truro. One of those churches was Emmanuel Baptist Church, which meets today at the top of Yonge Street. A child, maybe you could say, one of the children of First Baptist Church. Groundswell was birthed out of Emmanuel Baptist Church. So in some ways, you could say that we are the grandchildren of First Baptist Church. I believe that this grouping of people, they just saw potential in their town for what God could do here. And they wanted to be a part of that. They wanted to be his church, his representatives here in this town. And I also believe that when First Baptist Church gifted us the building, they saw potential that Groundswell could continue to be that kind of light, that kind of hope, that kind of community in the heart of Truro that could continue to bring more of God's kingdom to our community. It's an awesome responsibility, but one that comes with very little weight, because we are not building the church. Jesus is building the church, but he's inviting us to come and be a part of it. And I don't know for you today what maybe could be a barrier to that for you. Maybe you can't see in yourself the potential that Jesus sees in you. But I want to encourage you today that he has placed something unique and special in you. Regardless of your flaws or your failures or the way that you feel like you have faltered maybe in the last little while, God has placed something unique and special in you. He sees potential in you to be a kingdom bearer in your community. And I believe that's what he's calling Groundswell to be in Truro in 2021. Will we be here in 151 years? It's kind of irrelevant. What's important is that in this moment, in this day, in this town, we can be kingdom bearers. We can bring more of God's kingdom to earth. We can bring more love and peace and hope and justice, inclusion, grace, mercy to the people around us. So if you are watching this today and you are wondering, what do I do? I want to encourage you today to spend some time talking to Jesus, listening to him, hearing from him. Allow him to lead you and guide you. Maybe you're watching this from another community. You can be God's hands and feet in the community wherever you are today, wherever he has placed you. He sees potential in you, even when we don't see it in ourselves. And so I encourage you today, dig in, lean into Jesus, listen to his voice, hear what he is saying to you, hear what he is inviting you into, because he has placed something unique and special, some potential in you that could impact the people around you. Wouldn't that be an awesome thing to do? Let's pray together. Lord God, we want to thank you today for just the uniqueness that you place in each person, the way you see us, the potential you see in us, Lord. And God, I pray for everybody watching today. Maybe there are people watching today that just feel far from you, feel like they could never be used by you, struggle to see the value that you have placed in them. And Lord, today I pray that would all change, that they would take time to hear from you, to hear your voice, to be reminded of who they are, who you see them as. And Lord, I pray for multiple opportunities for us to be your hands and feet in the communities that you've placed us in, to use what you have given to us to bring more of heaven to earth. Lord, I thank you for inviting us to be part of the church that you are building. And I'm thankful, Lord, today that it's not dependent on us, but you invite us into it. And that is such an honor. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
So great to be with you today. If you are watching this Sunday morning or sometime during Sunday afternoon, you still have time to join us for our 6 p.m. gathering. It's going to be an awesome night of worship. We'd really love to see you there. Have a great week, everyone. We'll see you next Sunday.